after me. I'm a man. I'm 40.
And he strikes like thunderbolt.
We begin with a funeral attended by our favorite promiscuous martini-swilling degenerate gambling spy, James Bond, who promptly sucker punches a grieving widow in the face. After realizing an enemy he thought was dead is actually a drag queen, 007 escapes in Boba Fett's jetpack. While vacationing at an STI clinic, James sexually blackmails the staff and gets plenty of use out of a mint glove before almost being murdered by a Bowflex machine. He subsequently uncovers a plot to have a Spectre operative kill and replace the identity of a NATO pilot with the help of Michael Jackson's plastic surgeon. Spectre's plot, seemingly the blueprint for so many future lazy Bond storylines, is to crash land a nuclear bomber in the ocean near the Bahamas, retrieve the stolen warheads, and extort $100 million from the West in an act of nuclear blackmail. 007 follows his secret agent Spidey senses to Nassau, where he finds Emilio Largo, Spectre's number two agent, and clearly a bad guy because he wears an eye patch. Bond meets and seduces Largo's lover, Domino, who also happens to be the Spectre pilot, Jack Patachi's sister. After some aquatic sexcapades, postcoital James manipulatively uses her brother's death to turn her against her boyfriend, Largo. After meeting and boning a third woman, a Spectre agent named Fiona Volpe, Bond casually uses her as a human shield before going scuba diving. In Nassau, 007 meets yet another iteration of Felix Leiter. They team up for some sharky scuba action, and after finding the location of the nukes, they send in the US Army frogmen. What ensues is a painfully long action scene that's less interesting than watching flora and fauna grow in real time. Bond finally infiltrates Largo's luxury ship, the Disco Volante, and in a scene full of lazy and hopelessly dated rear projection, recycle footage, and awkward sped-up frame rates, Bond takes out the bad guy and ends up in the ocean with Domino, firing off his red rocket in yet another dinghy to end the film.
We open on deep space. We have an American shuttle is swallowed by one of the worms from Tremors. We cut to Hong Kong, and after comparing relative flavors of international women in a flophouse, English sex addict James Bond fakes his own death by Murphy bed. He's thrown overboard in the harbor and somehow swims to Tokyo to investigate the space shuttle disappearance. Along the way, he fights a guy with a couch, has a hot tub orgy with a guy named Tiger, flies a mini helicopter, bangs a Fiona Volpe wannabe, and engages in the single most blatant case of cultural misappropriation in motion picture history. He ultimately tracks down and makes arch nemeses out of Ernst Stavro Blofeld by destroying his piranha-infested hollowed-out volcano lair, along with hundreds of ninjas and a girl in a bikini.
Showing a shocking lack of visible grief over the recent murder of his wife in On Her Majesty's Secret Service, our weathered-looking, functional alcoholic super spy James Bond gets revenge by beating the shit out of a bunch of ethnically diverse henchmen. After 007 tracks Blofeld to a plastic surgery dungeon only the Real Housewives of New York would feel comfortable in, James dumps him into a mud bath, exfoliating him to death and sending him straight to hell.
Welcome to hell, Blofeld.
Back in London, 007 meets up and passive-aggressively belittles M for his liver problems and lack of knowledge of sherry vintage. They discuss the suspicious disappearance of a large number of diamonds from South African mines, and Bond is sent to Amsterdam to investigate the red light district. Posing as a diamond smuggler and with the help of Q's fake fingerprints, James bamboozles ginger jewel thief Tiffany Case into helping transport the diamonds to the classiest part of the United States.
Vegas!
Vegas, baby! Vegas!
Meanwhile, a couple of assassins, Mr. Kid, looking like he's escaped the costume room at the Muppet Show, and Mr. Wint, who uses more cologne than an Italian football locker room, show up to thwart Bond's plans. Although they don't play for the same team as James, Wint and Kid are also on the hunt for the stolen diamonds, and accompanied by some creepy-ass musical scoring bump off anyone that gets in their way. While in Vegas, James gets cremated, kidnapped by the cast of The Sopranos, and checks into the Tropicana. There, he meets Plenty O'Toole, a buxom barmaid playing craps at a casino. After taking her back to his hotel room, Plenty is unceremoniously dumped, while Bond gets caught with more than just his hands up. 007 rendezvous with Tiffany Case, and they go to the Vegas circus. For what reason? I'm still not sure. In a sequence that can only be described as an ether-fueled hallucinogenic nightmare, we see rigged carnival games, elephants playing slot machines, and horrific racial stereotypes. After Miss Case gives CIA surveillance the slip, Bond finds her and they follow a scientist to a research facility. Here, they learn how the moon landing was faked and participate in one of the most anticlimactic, boring car chases in movie history. After yet another Blues Brothers-style car chase through the garish streets of the Vegas Strip, James gets on top of the situation.
I'm on top of the situation.
He then breaks into Howard Hughes's, aka Willard White's, swanky apartment. Rather than finding an enigmatic billionaire wearing Kleenex boxes for shoes, Bond finds his old nemesis, Blofeld, alive and roommates with a doppelganger sidekick cloned like Dolly the Sheep. Bond gets roofied in an elevator, and rather than laying some pipe, this time he gets stuck in one. After easily escaping, he makes his way to Willard White's Frank Lloyd Wright-style mansion, where he gets kicked in the nads by two girls named Bambi and Thumper. Tiffany Case is kidnapped by Blofeld while on his way to audition for the Golden Girls. 007's nemesis flees to a deep-sea oil rig, where he uses his diamond-encrusted space laser to cause nuclear accidents that produce spectacularly bad special effects. Bond assumes another false identity and manages, with the help of Tiffany's bikini bottoms, to replace the computer's targeting tape with a Rod Stewart cassette. Bond releases a balloon that alerts the U.S. Air Cavalry from Apocalypse Now. James uses a crane to ram Blofeld's sea capsule into the control center of the rig, which doesn't kill him, but causes injuries so severe that he's forced to wear a neck brace next time we see him in For Your Eyes Only. In the film's denouement, Mr. Wint and Mr. Kid try to blow up James with a cake on a cruise ship, but he defeats them with his barbecue skills and atomic wedgies. Of course, 007 ends up with the girl at the end, thus concluding one of the most batshit crazy plots ever conceived.
You walk in a room.
So we're going to open on the fragmented shell of formerly glorious super spy James Bond plottingly infiltrating a condemned compound that wouldn't pass a Florida building inspection. Armed with a flying fox and a pea shooter, James gets stabbed by a scantily clad honeypot and sent to a spa where he binges on high cholesterol contraband, screws the staff, and kills a guy with his own fetid pea. It's here where he stumbles upon a specter plot to steal a nuclear warhead involving Largo Part 2, a heroin addict, a plastic-clad dominatrix, and a reticulated python. Bond heads to the Bahamas, where he meets Mr. Bean and pulls a Revenge of the Nerd-style switcheroo to feel up the baddie's girlfriend, Vicky Vale. After kicking Largo's ass at the 80s Atari Star Wars arcade game and turning Fatima Blush into a fine particulate, James infiltrates Largo's mega-yacht to once again awkwardly advance on a woman 23 years his junior. He's ultimately joined by the aforementioned UN Jefferson, and the two desecrate priceless ancient artifacts before an underwater sequence that makes the glacial pace of Thunderball look like Hobbs and Shaw.